Direct cash transfers from all revenue has not been ruled out by the PPP. Christopher Ram will not appeal Chief Justice's ruling on house-to-house registration. So did Stubb during fight at Camp Ayangana. And in sport, Lara and Saran to mentor West Indies test squad during test series against India. These and more coming up after the break. Stay with us.
Beeson Windows and Doors, fully equipped to handle all your commercial projects. Whether you're constructing a small or large commercial building, residential property, or just upgrading your home, they got you covered. Beeson Windows and Doors, providing unmatched quality windows for your home, office, and commercial building. Located at 1228 Eccles Industrial Site. For more information, call 662-4197 or 226-1292.
Enroll at the elite Art Williams and Harriman Aeronautical Engineering School and graduate with an associate degree in aircraft maintenance engineering at the Eugene F. Curry International Airport, East Coast, Demerara, or call us on 222-2155 or 222-1210. Visit our website, www.aescanada.net, for more information. The Art Williams and Harriman Aeronautical Engineering School, investing in your future since 1993.
Modern Optical Service has made it even better by introducing its budgeted spectacle line, starting as low as $10,000 for single vision lens and $12,000 for bifocal lens, available in tinted or clear, complete spectacles at affordable prices. So hurry down to our main office at 316 Middle Street or Lot 14 Diamond Public Road opposite Demerara Bank. Enjoy over 60 years of eye care experience at affordable prices. Modern Optical Service, your eye care professionals.
You can be a millionaire by only spending $100 on a Daily Million ticket. Simply pick any five numbers from 1 to 26, or you can buy a quick pick for your chance to win the Daily Millions. Purchase your tickets daily, Monday through Saturday, to get a chance to win $1 million every day. So, feeling lucky? Then buy a Daily Millions ticket today. Remember, a ticket today could make you rich today.
New taste, new ingredients, introducing Ambrosial Chinese Sauce, a great way to enhance your fried rice, chow mein, and spaghetti. Ambrosial Chinese Sauce can also be used to flavor cook-up, pepper pot, stews, or even curries. Also check out our line of liquid seasoning for all fish and meat. Not forgetting, guys, number one pepper sauce. Ambrosial Foods, making food tastier and healthier.
Mark?
I'm in the kitchen.
This is amazing! I love your tiles!
Make an impression with the finest tiles imported by Lens. Lens has a huge selection of various tiles for your wall, floor, and pool needs. All of our tiles are of grade A quality, which are the highest quality tile rated. That means they last longer and are less likely to damage or crack. We're the sole distributor for many reputable companies around the world. At Lens, we have special deals for contractors and bulk shoppers. Shop at any of our locations to get the best in tiles. Lens, our product, your creation.
Good evening and welcome to this, our Friday, August 16, 2019 edition of News Update. I'm Sandy Ramutar. Our top story this evening. Opposition leader Bharat Jagdeo has made it known that his party has not ruled out monetary grants from the oil proceeds. However, it must be conditional for individual vulnerable groups.
As Guyana gets nearer to commercial oil production, opposition leader Bharat Jagdeo made it known that his party has been devising a plan to utilize the funds in an appropriate, responsible way. He noted that the party has not ruled out the conditional transfers of the oil revenues, but it must only be for the vulnerable.
We in the PPP don't rule out cash transfers to individual vulnerable groups.
The party had previously mentioned that some of the money the country will receive from the oil and gas sector will be placed behind projects that will benefit persons. Such projects, according to the party, include bolstering health services. Guyana is set to benefit largely from the new sector, but there is still no local content policy in place. Godfrey Brooms, MTV News Update.
Anil Nandlal, attorney for Christopher Ram, said the case has achieved its objective of thwarting the caretaker government's plan of using house-to-house registration as a vehicle to deregister persons. Therefore, he will not be appealing the Chief Justice's decision.
Attorney on behalf of Christopher Ram, Anil Nandlal, said he will not be appealing Chief Justice Roxanne George Welsh's decision that house-to-house registration is unconstitutional. In a statement, Nandlal said that the case achieved its principal objective of preventing thousands of persons from being deregistered from the National Register of Registrants. He said the position of an appeal will be reconsidered once appeals are being filed by the other parties in the proceedings. The Chief Justice ruled that the removal of names of persons already registered on the National Register of Registrants on the ground of non-residency is unlawful and that the scrapping of the existing database of registrants will be illegal. She repeatedly emphasized that the current official list of electors can be refreshed with a suitable claims and objections period and lawfully used for the next elections. The People's Progressive Party claimed victory in the Chief Justice's ruling after it was ruled that it is unconstitutional to deregister persons from the National Register of Registrants.
We tell you now, less than one day after being removed from the intensive care unit of the Georgetown Public Hospital, accident victim 26-year-old Irfan Ahmed succumbed to his injuries he sustained following an accident 2 Wednesday ago in Barbies. The now dead welder was reportedly on his way home from work when he was struck down by a speeding car at Shieldstown West Coast Barbies. The father of one took his last breath last evening, thus leaving family members in a state of shock since they were of the belief that he was on the road to recovery. It was reported that the young man had just left the Blamond Sugar Estate where he was employed up to the time of his demise. He was riding his bicycle when he was struck from behind by a motor car driven by an overseas-based Guyanese. As a result of the impact, the man was thrown off the bicycle and landed on the roadway. The driver was allegedly attempting to escape the scene, but was apprehended by public-spirited citizens and handed over to the police. The injured man was taken to the hospital where he was admitted. He sustained broken legs and arms, spinal and brain injuries. The driver of the motor car is yet to be charged and family members were concerned that the man would escape from being prosecuted. The Working People's Alliance has admitted that the coalition government made major blunders in office but has vowed to remain in the coalition for the next regional and general elections.
The Working People's Alliance, WPA, today admitted that the coalition has made many mistakes in office, which has diminished its support base.
First, at the policy level, the government has failed to satisfactorily tackle some of the structural problems that negatively affect the poor and the powerless in the society. Second, we believe that the government political strategies and tactics have allowed room for a resurgence of the PPP as a viable competitor for office at the coming election.
The WPA is dissatisfied with the overall management of the coalition, especially its refusal to meaningfully engage coalition partners in decision-making. However, despite those mistakes, the party feels that the government has done enough to warrant a second term. As such, the WPA will remain in the coalition for the next regional and general elections.
While the party will play its full role in the coalition's campaign, we feel that a supplementary campaign by the WPA is necessary. This decision was influenced by feedback we have received from coalition constituents and beyond that suggests that the WPA's particular political brand is needed on the ground in the communities.
Godfrey Brooms, MTV News Update.
Still to come after the break, soldiers stabbed during fight at Camp Ayangana, and in sport, Lara and Sarwan to mentor West Indies Test squad during Test series against India. This and more when we return. Stay with us.
Secure your property, secure your life. Get the best security service from us at KGM Security Services Incorporated. Highly trained armed and unarmed officers at affordable rates. We offer armed mobile patrols, personal security, cash escort, alarm monitoring, quick response units, also rental of executive vehicles with armed guards. 74 Axora Avenue, Bellier Park, Georgetown. Contact us on 663-3227, 699-0084 or 654-1800. KGM Security Services Incorporated. We are your source for security.
Friday 16th to Sunday 18th August, Cliff Anderson Sports Hall comes alive with the Guyana Amateur Boxing Association's 4th Annual Caribbean Schoolboys and Junior Boxing Tournament. It's a Caribbean invasion. Boxers from Haiti, Barbados, Cayman Islands, Trinidad and Tobago, Guyana, St. Lucia, Dominica, Grenada, Jamaica, and more. Admission stands $500 and ringside $1,500. And starting time 6 p.m. The Caribbean Schoolboys and Junior Boxing Tournament from Friday 16th to Sunday 18th August. Come out! Out and represent!
Did you know almost one-third of deaths in Guyana are heart-related? Chronic inflammation is the root cause of atherosclerosis, the process that leads to cholesterol-clogged arteries. You can now lower high triglyceride levels with Omega XL and reduce the dangerous inflammation that causes these problems. So to ensure a healthy heart and reduce your risk of disease, get your Omega XL today. Live long, stay strong with Omega XL.
John Lewis Styles carries back-to-school items. Besides clothing and footwear, you can also get lunch bags from $3,500, backpacks from $4,500, and pulley backpacks from $10,995, all for the same price or less than buying online, and it's already here. Also, get a chance to win one RCA tablet every week in August. Enter to win with every $5,000 you spend. That's four tablets you can Google homework with. John Lewis Styles. Simply different.
You know, since me find a Bataya Future Shop, me house look nicer than you one. Hey, hey, credit rate. How you can afford to buy all them things?
Let me tell you.
Now me not get catch again. I'm a secret.
No, come now, man. A magic. You're too fast. Mind the business.
Excuse me, Uncle. Tell me something. How credit can afford to buy so much thing from my honey now walk no way?
It's because now we introduce our new discount card.
Apply now for your discount card at Tayo Future Shop. Every time you shop using your discount card, your percentage increases. Start from 5% off. Your next purchase, 7% off. Then 10% off, etc. Until you start getting wholesale and factory price. Check in store for more details. Conditions apply.
Help me get me Tayo discount card.
Wait, man. What you gotta do next, man? Buy the whole entire store?
Welcome back. You're watching MTV's News Update. A soldier is said to be listed in a critical condition in a Georgian public hospital after he was stabbed during an altercation at Camp Bayangana. While details of the incident remains sketchy, News Update learned that the man was involved in an argument with another soldier when a scuffle ensued and he was stabbed. The army is reportedly trying to keep the issue under wraps, but a source at the military base confirmed that the soldier who launched the attack has since been dismissed. One senior officer, when contacted, declined to comment, stating he is not part of the army's public relations department and therefore could not speak on the issue. Efforts to contact the PR department were futile as calls to the office went unanswered. Former Agriculture Minister under the People's Progressive Party government, Dr. Leslie Ramsamy, wants the escalating paddy bug infestation to be declared an emergency.
For some time now, farmers from regions 2, 3, 5 and 6 have been battling an infestation of paddy bugs on their rice lands and crops. Farmers are estimated to have lost billions in paddy bags, with damages closely to 20% of crops across the region. For this reason, former Agriculture Minister Dr. Leslie Ramsamy wants the ongoing paddybug infestation to be declared an emergency. Dr. Ramsamy said it is paramount that the Ministry of Agriculture takes the lead in the fight against the paddybug emergency. He lashed out at the caretaker government, saying that the administration is largely missing in action, ignoring the suffering of farmers. He said the Ghana Rice Development Board and the Ministry of Agriculture have neglected and allowed the paddybug infestation to escalate and is now an emergency. While the Ghana Rice Development Board has received assistance from the Latin American Fund to tackle the bug infestation, farmers are not accepting the suggestions put forward. Farmers are contending that the recommendations put forward are things they are already doing to alleviate the situation.
Four men are now being grilled by the police for their alleged involvement in several armed robberies committed in various villages in quarantine Barbies, iNews Guyana reports. The four were arrested at Rose Hall and Lancaster Village, quarantine Barbies, earlier today. The website quoted Commander of B Division, Senior Superintendent Paul Langevin, as saying the men were arrested during a cordon and search initiative that had been carefully planned and executed by ranks in the division. He further stated that after the crimes were committed, the police would have received information about the suspects, and as such, the exercise was conducted. Investigations are ongoing. Fraser's Educational Institute, a private educational institution in Region 5, continues to succeed against all odds, amassing a whopping 98.4% pass rate at this year's CSEC examinations. 42 students of the institution wrote the examinations.
During an interview with this newscast earlier today, the top-performing students of the private school related their elation and hard work done behind their studies leading up to the exams. 16-year-old Alia Sheriff, who wrote 17 subjects and achieved 9 grade 1s, 6 grade 2s and 2 grade 3s, explained she did a lot of extra research and lessons about a full year leading into the exams.
I would say it wasn't easy. It was very hard. You had to put in a lot of commitment. And so with the help of teachers, the principal himself too, being a strong leader, I had his support, my family's support, as well as God, the main guy up there. So I went through it quite slowly and surely, and so I was very happy with my results.
Also 16-year-old and the students of Fraser's Educational Institute are Daryl Joseph and Navindra Lal. Joseph wrote 11 subjects and gained grade 1s in all, while Lal, who also wrote 11 subjects, gained 10 grade 1s and 1 grade 2.
Well, before the examination started, we were still doing SBAs, which was very hard to complete and preparing for CXC, but we still made it due to the help of teachers and putting in hard works and late nights.
Well, upon examination, friends weren't and spending time with them weren't really an option, because I knew that studying for CXC and to achieve my goals would be the best choice, not partying with friends or anything. And I just kept studying and just keep going to school every day.
As for 16-year-old Ricardo Balcaram and 16-year-old Shastri Singh, the sky is the limit in them achieving their goals. Like their fellow classmates, the two students both intend to attend the University of Guyana.
I would like to further my studies by doing KIPP, sixth form, and then attend the University of Guyana to become a physician.
I will start the University of Guyana soon. We'll join the University of Guyana to study civil engineering. Yeah, soon as possible.
Some of the other top-performing schools in the country are Anna Regina Secondary School, Region 2, Queen's College, St. Rose's High, Region 4, Saraswati Vidya Nikatan, Region 3, Abrahams Zuhil Secondary, Region 2, Rosignal Secondary, Region 5, Tagore Secondary School, Region 6, Mays Secondary, Region 4, Diamond Secondary, Region 4, St. Stanislaus College, Region 4, Skeldon Lying Path Secondary, Region 6, and Isa Islamic Academy, Region 4. Reporting for MTV News Update, Lashona Gomes, Cornelius.
A West Bank Demerara teenager is in a critical condition at a Jurchung Public Hospital after he was chopped to the neck and other parts of his body during a fight at a football game yesterday at the Stanley Town Playfield. Newsroom is reporting. According to the website, 18-year-old Sian Griffith of Seoul School Street, Sanlitun, was rushed to the West Demerara Regional Hospital by public-spirited persons after the incident. Newsroom quoted his sister Tyra Quick as saying her brother just wrote CSEC exams and while awaiting his results, he started to play football with other youths at the community play field. Yesterday, Griffith left home about 16 hours and about 2 hours later, the family received the devastating news. Griffith was subsequently transferred to the Jurjang Public Hospital for emergency surgery. The sister said her brother identified two men from the community as the suspects. Newsroom said that the family was told that the fight started when the teen innocently tackled one of the suspects during the game. Meanwhile, the teen's mother, Nadia Patterson, was quoted as saying she's not satisfied with the police investigation. According to the mother, reports were made to the Lagrange and Wales police stations. Exactly 9 weeks after the mysterious death of 28-year-old Stephen Francis, while he was a patient at a National Psychiatric Hospital, his mother Marlene Prince is demanding justice for her son. The woman is also accusing the Ministry of Public Health of being insensitive and never reaching out to her, even in her time of grief.
On Monday, June 10, 2019, 28-year-old Stephen Francis, then a patient of the National Psychiatric Hospital, New Amsterdam, Berbice, was allegedly beaten by two male patients of the said institution and died several hours later. The incident, which was reportedly witnessed by a staff nurse on duty that night, occurred mere hours after Francis celebrated his birthday in the company of his mother and other relatives. The victim's mother, Maylene Prince, strongly believed that both police investigators and the Ministry of Public Health are dragging their feet on the matter. The two alleged perpetrators involved in her son's death are said to have been placed back into the care of the National Psychiatric Hospital.
I went back to the DPP office and the complaint department last week, Wednesday. Right? They said to me, give them some time. By Friday time, the file is supposed to come down. The file, I was there since after the funeral, before the funeral, after the funeral, I went to them. Right? And the commissioner keep calling him, going, coming. They got me back and forth. Right? Concerning my child incident. Right? They try to tell me they got to wait for post-mortem results. And they got to get, they call some nurse have to give a report. Now, if you didn't get post-mortem results, how you release these two guys?
Trying to hold back tears, Prince explained since her son died, she is constantly reminded of the fond memories she shared with her son when he was alive and in better senses.
I want them to now got to get justice to me because that's a dark copy I make. If a dark copy child get laid down for the road, they don't move from there, right? There's not a child who I didn't care if I care for my child. I love my child. I die here. I cannot sleep. I can't eat. I find it and I'm so stressed that I'm fast. Right?
Though an autopsy report would later indicate Stephen Francis died from choking on a piece of meat, Prince reiterated that her son's body bore several stab wounds to the back of the head, neck, and ribs. Following the death of Stephen Francis, two patients of the said psychiatric institute, Jason James and Marlon Trim, were arrested and detained by CID officers. After several days under arrest, the two were released and sent back to the National Psychiatric Hospital. This newscast initially contacted the Director of Regional Health Services, Region 6, Jevon Stephen, and was informed that the matter was being investigated by the Ministry of Public Health. Stephen also noted following a thorough investigation, certain recommendations would be put into place to ensure such an incident does not recur at the institution. However, efforts to further contact Stephen on the matter proved futile. Reporting for MTV News Update, Lashona Gomes, Cornelius.
Here is Celine Griffith with MTV's Court Roundup.
A pensioner yesterday appeared before Magistrate Judy Latchman at the Providence Magistrates Court to answer for allegedly attempting to smuggle cocaine out of the country. 66-year-old Roderick Andrew Chase denied the charge which alleged on August 13 at CJIA Temeri. He had 290 grams of cannabis in his possession for the purpose of trafficking. According to reports, on the day in question, Chase was an outgoing passenger destined for Brooklyn, New York. However, while going through the X-ray scanner, ranks attached to the police narcotics branch observed objects in his shoes. A search allegedly revealed two parcels suspected to be cocaine inside the shoes. Bail was refused and Chase was remanded to prison until August 30. In another matter, a bus driver was today hauled before Magistrate Leron Daly to answer to an assault charge. Adrian Brandt pleaded guilty to the charge which read that on August 9th at the Route 47 minibus park Starbrook, he assaulted Eric Lang so as to cause actual bodily harm. According to reports, the virtual complainant, who is a conductor, had a confrontation with the defendant on the day in question. Reports further indicate that the defendant scrambled the victim and dealt him lashes with a wood. In his defense, an unrepresented Brandt told the magistrate that he was also assaulted and that he has a medical as proof. However, police prosecutor Tracy Ann Gittins told the court that Brandt has a history of aggression and that he is currently awaiting trial for rape. As such, Adrian Brandt was sentenced to 6 weeks in prison for the offense. Finally, a man was today placed before the court to answer to a break and enter and larceny charge. Moni Lal called Sonny denied a charge which read that between the 13th and 14th of August at Sussex Street, Charlestown, he broke and entered a mechanic shop of Sean Clark and sold therein three motorcycle parts valued $20,000, two batteries and a quantity of tools reaching the total value of $300,000. In his defense, the man told the magistrate that he works at the mechanic shop. However, the prosecution objected to bail based on the fact that the man has no fixed place of abode. As such, bail was refused and he was remanded to prison until August 30. Reporting for MTV's Court Roundup, Celine Griffith.
We now join Rajesh Lakhan with your weekly entertainment guide.
Good evening and welcome to MTV News Update Entertainment Guide. We begin with the 13th annual Guyana Cup Horse Race Meet and After Show this Sunday at the Rising Sun Turf Club in Burbies.
What the patrons should expect? A day of fun. It's no longer a big boy sport. It's a family-oriented event, which that's the way we're promoting it, because horse racing is fun. And for me, it's very addictive. Once you invite someone to horse racing for the first time, you can be assured at the next meeting they'll be present. So this one wouldn't be anything different. I know after Sunday you'll be visiting us again in September and in December for the other meetings. Correct.
Great. In terms of the horses, tell us how many horses, and you have overseas horses as well?
Yes, of course. We have horses from Canada, the United States of America, Trinidad, Jamaica. We have some lines from Barbados here, and our locally bred horses. For me, we no longer have locally bred horses, because when you look at the genetics that were imported over the years, you can consider our horses local Americans. That's the way I see them, because they're just as good as the imported ones.
And how many races set for Sunday?
So far we're looking at eight events.
Now, I already know that there is $20 million up for grabs.
That's right.
Aside from that, tell us about the after show.
All right, well, if you look at the list of artists, you know, and the races that we have in Guyana, six races, we catered for everybody.
Can you give us a few names, the artists that they perform?
Oh, well, you have my guy, K.I. Yes, he's my guy, because the dance, I've been doing it at my staff party for the past 2 years, and it's still my song. We have the Jamaicans, we have Munger and those guys. We have some from Trinidad, some others from Trinidad. So you can expect a very dynamic show and our local artists.
And the 19th edition of Hits and Jams Jam Zone Summer Break kicks off this evening and will conclude on Sunday with a series of events featuring both local and international artists. To tell us about all events and artists booked to perform, I spoke with a representative out of Hits and Jams, Alia.
How are you?
I'm good, how are you?
I'm just preparing for the Jam Zone season. As you know, tonight we start off with our Juve. It's going to happen on the Kingston PTC wall, right behind the St. Stanislaus ground.
Great, tell us about the headline artists for tomorrow night as well as Sunday.
So we've got Popcorn tomorrow night. He should be coming in tonight around 10 p.m. A lot of people are excited. I think that's the most anticipated concert event for the Jam Zone season, rather. And then on Sunday we go to our Beach Jam. That's going to be at the AJ Waterworld. Tickets cost $2,000. It's gonna be not really a family-oriented event because we're gonna have a lot of games which is adult-based, like beer pong. We've got the chicken fight in the pool, but that's gonna be the close-off event.
That's Sunday.
Yeah, that's Sunday.
Tomorrow night, that popcorn event. Any other artists later for her?
Yes, we have Munga and Gage, all dancehall artists. Yeah. Tonight also we have Christo. He is mostly known for the Red Gal song. I'm pretty sure you're okay with that. Yeah. And we have Mandela. He sang the song called Tombstone. Yeah.
Very good. Speaking of the Red Girl song, are you offended by that song?
No, I'm not. We're very stereotyped, so I know what I am.
Coming up after the break, MTV's sports update and more. Stay with us.
Let FiberTech help you to renovate, refresh, and redecorate your kitchen. Spice up your kitchen with decorative colors, finishes, and accessories. Choose from an array of designs and beautiful granite colors that are blended to suit your choice. FiberTech Lifetime Kitchen is durable, termites-free, and water-resistant. Enjoy 1-year factory warranty, along with our after-sale service. So come on in and let us help you choose wisely.
Are you invited to that important event but don't know what to wear or frustrated you're wearing the same dress as everyone else? You crave for this exclusive look? Then do just that with dresses from Exclusive Dresses to Impress. Visit Exclusive Dresses to Impress at Gifland Mall. Contact number 6570166.
Now using Softex toilet tissue. Available in leading supermarkets countrywide, Softex is always silky smooth because it's made from virgin pulp and babies love it. Softex comes available in single rolls, economy pack, six pack, and one dozen packages. Just perfect for any budget. Manufactured and distributed by BPATS Paper Manufacturing, Eccles Industrial Site. For more information, telephone 622-4197.
The Ghana Elections Commission will commence house-to-house registration in your area soon. You must register if you are a Guyanese citizen by birth, descent, naturalization, or registration. 14 years and older by the 31st of October 2019, a citizen of a Commonwealth country living in Guyana for a period of no less than 1 year preceding the qualifying date. If you were previously registered, you will need to register again. Look out for GCOM. Make it your responsibility to get registered. For more information, contact GCOM on 225-0277-9 or 223-9653. Email pro@gcom.org.gy. Contact the nearest GCOM registration office or visit our website, www.gcom.org.gy.
It happens. Your septic tank is full. All the waste from your toilet goes into your septic tank through the sewage line. When your tank is full, the two most common indicators are an overflowing tank and an overflowing toilet. It is recommended that Sevon's Waste Management empty your septic tank every 2 to 3 years to avoid any embarrassment. And before you can say, shh, it's gone. Call Sevon's Waste Management today at 218-1455 or 218-1156.
With almost 20 years of experience at Gaffer's, Kamla can advise you on all your flatpack requirements. Let her show you her wide range of PVC ceilings in more than 10 colors and designs. Laminated bamboo and PVC floorings complete with accessories. Granite countertops, cabinet doors, plywood and MDF board. Moldings in a variety of designs, both wooden and plastic. For your roof, she has asphalt roofing shingles, tar felt, nails and drip edges.
gypsum board, and she has plain and decorative cement board. For that attractive look, she has full brick panels, which will not crack or fade nor peel. So let our expert Kamala advise you on all these products and more. And for your safety, don't forget Mexin Steel Security Doors with 8 security locks. Remember, for all your flat pack needs, see Kamala or call her on 225-6686 at Gafoors, a name you can trust.
Over the years, ISG has been providing all sectors across Guyana with quality products and outstanding customer service. Proud distributor of NP and Ultra lubricants, engineered for tropical conditions. International Trucks and Parts, leading the change. SEM Machinery, a Caterpillar brand. SKF Bearings and Mounted Products. Napa Batteries. Tide Power Generators. Discover the greatest source of power. Industrial Supply of Guyana Inc. The best opportunity to make the right choice.
Welcome to MTV's Sports Update. Two former West Indies captains will join the regional team's preparation ahead of the upcoming test series against India.
Brian Lara, one of the greatest batsmen of all time, and Ramnir Sarwan, who was one of the leading players of his generation, will be part of the West Indies pre-series camp to be held in Antigua ahead of the first test match against India. They will share their immense knowledge, experience and expertise with the members of the 13-member squad ahead of the series. West Indies and India will play two tests from August 22 to 26 at the Sir Vivian Richards Cricket Ground in North Sound, Antigua, and from August 30 to September 3 at Sabina Park in Kingston, Jamaica. Jimmy Adams, Cricket West Indies' director of cricket, was grateful to Lara and Sarwan for coming on board and offering their time to interact with the young batsmen as they get ready for their crucial two-match series, which will signal the start of the new ICC World Test Championship for both teams. He said that the CWI would have seen some good young batsmen in the team, who they believe will form the future of West Indies cricket, and that such a decision was taken to have Lara and Sarwan work with these players, who have demonstrated a will to learn and succeed. Lara 50 is the leading run scorer in West Indies history with 11,953 runs in 131 test matches. His mammoth 400 not out against England in Antigua in 2004 remains the only occasion a batsman has reached a quadruple century in test history. He also holds the record for the highest first-class score of all time, the monumental 501 not out for the Warwickshire in the English Country Championship. Sarwan, 39, scored 5,842 runs in 87 test matches, including 15 centuries, with a top score of 291 against England in Barbados a decade ago. In one-day internationals, he also scored 5,845 runs in 169 innings. Celine Griffith reporting for MTV Sports Update.
England's charge through the Australia batting was halted by more rain on another wet day at Lord's. The home side reduced the Ashes holders to 80 for 4, trailing by 178 on the third day of the second test before rain wiped out the final two sessions to go with the abandonment of the first day. In the 24.1 overs possible, England's bowlers recovered from a poor start to pressure Australia into losing 3 wickets for 11 runs. As they allowed the Tories to move from 11 for 1 to 6 for 1, England were in danger of wasting perfect bowling conditions. But debutant Jofra Archer took his first test wicket, followed by one each for Chris Wokes and Stuart Broad. Still, England were unable to find a way to remove prolific Australia batsman Steve Smith, who remains on 13 not out. Given there are only 2 days of play remaining, Saturday and Sunday are forecast to be dry, it may be that there is not enough time for England to force the win that would level the series at 1-1. For there to be a positive result, the Tories would have to bat it beyond England and bowl them out on the final day, or the hosts would need to wrap up the innings quickly, then get far enough ahead to be able to attack Australia's batsmen again on Sunday. Over 100 top karatekas in the Caribbean are expected here later this month as the Guyana Karate College hosts its annual IKD, Guyana Caribbean Karate Cup competition from August 23 to 25 at the Cliff Anderson Sports Hall.
Competitors from Antigua and Barbuda, Barbados, Grenada, Jamaica, St. Lucia, St. Vincent and the Grenadines, Trinidad and Tobago and Venezuela are confirmed to participate in the 2019 IKD Caribbean Karate Cup. With Guyana fielding about 100 athletes, participants attending this competition would number in excess of 200. Athletes will be competing in individual events such as kata and kumite or sparring. There will also be several team events including in kata, kumite, bankai and enbu. Guyanese World Karate Master Frank Wunutai, who heads the International Karate Daigaku organization, which has representation in 70 regions in 50 countries worldwide, said this event is another milestone in the history of traditional karate in Guyana and the region. Several 8 and 7 dan masters will be attending to support fair judging, and competition will be fierce. Admission is $500, except for overseas delegations considering the above, and the GKC expects the Cliff Anderson Sports Hall to be packed to full capacity. The action begins at 9 a.m. on Saturday, August 23, with all kata, enbu, and bankai events. Beginning at the same time on Sunday, August 24, will be kumite events along with bankai and enbu demonstrations. The opening ceremony will take place on August 24. Celine Griffith reporting for MTV Sports Update.
We tell you now that former world number one Andy Murray says he will play no part in this month's U.S. Open. The 2012 champion had intended to play doubles in New York, but says doubles is done for me for the time being. Instead, he will play singles at next week's ATP event in Winston-Salem before considering entering a tournament on the Challenger Tour during the U.S. Open. Murray has taken the final wild card for next week's event in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. He will join Kevin Anderson, Denis Shapovalov, Thomas Burdick, and Britain's Dan Evans in the draw. A retired racing driver and his family have survived a plane crash in the U.S. state of Tennessee. Former NASCAR driver Dale Earnhardt Jr., his wife and daughter escaped without serious injury, officials said. The plane ran off the runway and caught fire after landing at the Elizabethan Municipal Airport at 1540 local time on Thursday. Two pilots were flying the plane, the Federal Aviation Administration said. Video from the airport shows firefighters attempting to quell a blaze ripping through the plane, a Cessna Citation, as black smoke billows into the air. In a tweet, Mr. Earnhardt's sister said everyone on board the plane was safe. More news after the break. Stay with us.
Ready to ride away winter on a brand new motorcycle? With Ultra Lubricants Oil & Go, it's so easy. Purchase any Ultra Lubricants at an authorized dealer. Get your coupon, fill it out, drop it in the box, and you can be one of six lucky Ultra winners to ride off on a bike. And here's the secret tip. Get two chances to win when you purchase Ultra Power Max 4T. Ride away a winner. Oil & Go with Ultra Lubricants. Promotion runs from 1st of March to the 31st of August. Conditions apply. See press and Facebook for details. Ultra Lubricant. Distributed by Industrial Supply of Guyana, Inc. And available nationwide.
Welcome back. You're still with MTV's News Update. Now for some news in the region. Details provided by the sole survivor of a torture center in Brazil could lead to the imprisonment of a man accused of raping her during her captivity. The accused has so far been shielded by 1979 amnesty law, which prevents military officials from being prosecuted for crimes committed under military rule. But now a court has ruled that he should stand trial for the alleged rape of Ines Ethiana Remo, who managed to survive her time at the clandestine torture center by pretending she had been tortured by her captors. More than 400 people were killed or disappeared during Brazil's military rule, and Ms. Romo detailed account of her months in captivity at the clandestine prison dubbed House of Death were key in bringing information about the military's excesses to light. The ruling comes at a time when far-right President Jair Bolsonaro has expressed nostalgia for the time when Brazil was under military rule. On the international scene, U.S. Congresswoman Rashida Tlaib has rejected Israel's offer to allow her to make a humanitarian visit to her grandmother in the occupied West Bank. Ms. Tlaib said that she could not comply with the oppressive conditions being imposed. A critic of Israeli policy towards the Palestinians, she had been blocked by Israel from making an official visit. But it said a private visit could go ahead after she agreed not to promote the boycott of Israel during her stay. Ms. Tlaib and fellow Democratic Congresswoman Ian Omar had originally been due to make an official visit to the West Bank and East Jerusalem from Sunday. Under pressure from U.S. President Donald Trump, Israel denied permission for the visit to territory it controls. And that has brought us to the end of regional and international news. Now let's take a look at the Canada Stock Exchange closing prices for trading session 8:38. Let's now turn our attention to the Demer Harbour Bridge and the Burbese River Bridge schedules. That's a wrap on today's broadcast. Before we go, here's a reminder of our top stories. Direct cash transfers to mall revenue has not been ruled out by the PPP. Christopher Rao will not appeal Chief Justice's ruling in house-to-house registration. Soldiers stabbed during fight at Camp Ahingane. And in sport, Lara and Sawan to mentor West Indies test squad during test series against India. Qatari broadcasts at 22 hours today and at 6 hours 30 tomorrow. On behalf of our news and technical teams, I'm Sandy Ramutar. Thank you for watching. Have a good night.